Good afternoon. Welcome to our forum on sustainable agriculture. My name is Jeff Potent. I'm an adjunct professor at the School of International and Public Affairs and the Earth Institute. And I'd like to welcome you all to the second of our forums on sustainable agriculture. We have a wonderful panel today, but first I want to go through our long list of thank yous, because as with any endeavor, it takes many people. This is a partnership between the Tamer Center for Social Enterprise here at the Business School and the School of International and Public Affairs, as well as the Earth Institute. So I want to thank all the faculty and staff who from those institutions who helped pull this together today. And most notably, I want to thank Joyce Zhao, who's my student assistant, who has been doing most of the work in making this happen, and the few other of my students who've offered to volunteer to help out today. A bit of housekeeping. If you need to leave during the session, please go out through the side door. And in fact, if you expect to be leaving during the session, please sit over to the left side. The bathrooms are on, the men's bathroom is to the right on this floor, and the ladies' bathroom is to the right, the floor below us. Okay. And also, we have a Twitter hashtag. So if you're uncomfortable about coming up to the mic during our Q&A session, feel free to send us a Twitter, and I don't know the terminology, to tweet us, rather, and we'll be glad to handle some of the questions depending on the volume. We're also videotaping today, so if you want to watch this again or direct your friends to watch it, it will be archived on the Earth Institute website. And I need my glasses so I can see what I'm doing. Last year, we focused on the corporate sector because I had experienced in working with many very large agricultural companies, including companies that probably don't have the greatest reputation as related to sustainability, that there was actually a lot of very innovative work going on in the very conventional cadre of the ag community. And it appeared important to highlight that activity. So we had guest speakers from Smithfield Corporation and from the dairy industry, and covered a lot of topics related to some of the innovation that's happening in the corporate sector. Now, granted, that innovation is clearly incremental. It's within the existing modern agricultural approach. But the work was quite substantial. The dairy industry, for example, has a major sustainability effort throughout their entire supply chain. Smithfield had been doing a lot of very innovative work in crop management, and we felt it was important to highlight that work. And today, we're going to be focusing on small agriculture. And we've got so many terms for it, and I hope our speakers will refine all the terminology, because it's everything from small, local, regenerative, sustainable. We have so many terms to describe a broad array of activities, and I'll touch on some of the constructs before turning it over to the speakers. But there are certain essential elements which are very much worth highlighting, and I'll try to do that before we get started. But I've got this wonderful painting from Norman Rockwell, which I think is a great way to start this discussion. It looks like a wonderful bucolic image of an old-time family farm, which it is to some extent, except it also marks the beginning of industrial agriculture, because the fellow standing by the cow is the agricultural extension agent, and he's measuring the cow and instructing the daughter of the farmer in how to conduct modern agriculture. And if you see, she has a 4-H book. She's part of our national 4-H program, training program for young adults interested in entering agriculture. But the dad, the farmer, is off in the distance. Everybody else is kind of interested, but this is the transition point. This is the time when mechanized approaches, organized, structured approaches to agriculture are beginning to work their way out to the field. And this is actually a real family farm. Well, it was actually a real family farm. So what is sustainable agriculture? I tried to boil it down to the most basic terms. It is agriculture that feeds and nourishes people, restores and protects the land, air, water, and other species on our planet, and I know here in parentheses, across the full product life cycle, because agriculture is not just raising crops or animals out in the field. It's the distribution, the processing, the retail, restaurants, everything from farm to fork is often described. And we'll be talking about the entire food system today. And it's sustainable agriculture is resilient and helps to mitigate climate change and provides livelihoods and dignity for farmers, workers, families, and rural communities. This is a tall order, obviously, and much of our agriculture is not meeting these objectives. So we have many exciting initiatives, again, at all scales within the agricultural community and many stakeholders, either longtime stakeholders in the ag community or people who have just become interested in food and agriculture who are now weighing in this process. There's a funding mechanism at the federal level called the U.S. Farm Bill. It's actually a statute, but it's referred to as a farm bill, and it has to be reauthorized every 5 years or so, and there's always a great deal of debate and stakeholder engagement around, or stakeholder input into this process. It's the largest funding mechanism for agriculture and food assistance in our country. And in the last round, the 2014 Farm Bill, there were far more stakeholders from many different groups, good government groups, environmental groups, local groups in urban areas, all for the first time coming to the table to get actively involved in developing farm policy in this country. And many people are now engaged because they understand this broad vision of what agriculture is or should be. We're facing many challenges in moving to this ideal or this hopeful vision of what agriculture could and should be. One of the biggest challenges we face is climate change. Agriculture is heavily impacted by climate change and is also a contributing factor to climate change. And this is a chart from the third synthesis report of the United Nations Intergovernmental Platform on Climate Change. This is a compilation of about 1,000 studies projecting how agricultural yields will be affected by climate change. And these studies are not standardized. They cover different periods of time, different parts of the world. And this was the UN's attempt to at least gain a profile of what the science is saying about agricultural yield into the future under various climate change scenarios. And I should add that most of the 1,000 studies do not consider climate change above 4 degrees Celsius. And hopefully that will never be the case, but there's no guarantee that we will stay below 4 or even the 2 degrees that's now the international goal. But as you can see, in the period up until 2029, we're seeing on average maybe perhaps a little bit of an increase in agricultural yield because some areas are becoming more hospitable for agriculture. But as we move through the 21st century, we see that there's going to be there's projections for far more reductions in agricultural yield than gains. And as we move out to the end of the century, you could see that there's some expectations that in some areas of the world, we're actually going to see agricultural collapse. So we are facing significant challenges, and agriculture is going to have to adapt to these challenges. As the folks in the industry often say, if we're going to be feeding 9.5 billion people by 2050. And we're already seeing the effects on agriculture as a result of climate change. Many of you don't realize this, but scientists have proven that the severe drought in Syria was in part exacerbated by climate change. It was the worst drought of record in that region, which contributed to significant unrest, a lot of migration from rural areas into cities, and was a contributing factor that added to the stress that was already existing in the region that resulted, unfortunately, into the horrific war situation that we're seeing there. The State Department refers to climate change as a risk multiplier, meaning that they don't necessarily see it as causing, as a major causative factor for unrest, but they see it likely to be causing, contributing to problems throughout the world. So let's get positive now. By the way, that's only one of the many challenges that agriculture is facing. Sustainable agriculture is really many different things. There's no standard practice that is sustainable agriculture. This chart is just a summary of some areas of focus or approaches to sustainable agriculture. And at the top, I start with the more traditional approaches. Agriculture best management practice is really something that's been going on in this country since modern agriculture. And it is an iterative effort on the part of agricultural producers, land-grant universities, ag suppliers and technical assistance providers to test out best practices on the farm and supported by faculty and academic research to improve agricultural yield and now in more recent years to also include improving environmental and social performance. Rotational grazing is another approach which was a traditional farming approach which was lost to modern agriculture and is now being re-embraced for livestock operations. Sustainable intensification is a relatively new concept, and essentially what it refers to is sticking with the industrial model of agriculture, but using best science and best practices to get as much, to actually increase agricultural yield as much as possible on the existing agricultural land footprint. So it includes using modern technology like GPS, GIS, remote sensing, all bundled under a term called precision agriculture. And there has been a good amount of success in this area. I had visited a ConAgra facility, again, one of the big agribusiness corporations, and they talked about their sustainable intensification program working on their lands and their contract lands. And they've dramatically reduced the amount of chemical fertilizer, soil compaction, another problem in agricultural land, and pesticide use. All try to moving in the direction of more sustainable agricultural systems. So not to be discounted by any means. Bill McDonough and Michael Braungart, who are two leaders in the field of sustainable development, make a point that it's important to work with the corporate sector because even small changes implemented on a broad scale can have tremendous impact. They refer to this as speed and scale. So we're not talking about that dimension of agriculture today, but I wanted to keep the balance, understand that this is not a political movement. We've got to make real world progress. So we need to see and encourage progress throughout the system. And by the way, a lot of these approaches that are being implemented at the corporate scale were instigated by some of the local stuff they're going to be hearing about today. So there is a bit of cross-pollination. Climate Smart Agriculture is a UN approach that helps small shareholders to be able to continue to get agricultural yield and meet the needs of their families and adapt to climate change. Permaculture, restorative agriculture, holistic management, which John is going to talk a bit about, are all integrated farming systems, integrating crop, livestock, multi-cropping systems to mimic nature in agricultural systems. Local Ag Food Shed, we'll hear about that today from Kathleen. And multi-trophic aquaculture is something I wanted to mention because it's not agriculture on the land, it's fish farming basically, but there's been a lot of innovation in this area because half of the fish protein eaten by the world's population is coming from farmed operations. And unfortunately, just like intensive land farming, fish farming at that scale is having a lot of environmental negative impacts as well. So we need to be looking at those systems too. And it still is in a stage of innovation. There are some great models being tested, but we haven't figured out a way yet to do large scale fish farming without creating a whole host of ocean impacts. So we'll be answering this question throughout the day today. How are these approaches a departure from traditional and more conventional modern agricultural systems? And what are we hoping to achieve? In my conversation with John in preparation for the session, we were on a crummy cell phone line, and I said, well, I want to talk about the value of agriculture, of local agriculture. And John said, oh, did you say values? And I said, no, I meant value, but I want to talk about values too. So we're going to talk about what is the value of local agriculture in this global ag system that we're in, meaning what level of crop production can we produce, can we do this in a cost-effective way, all the classic economic discussions. But we're also going to be talking about the values associated with local agriculture, providing economic activity for local rural communities, right livelihood for farmers and farm workers, restoring ecological balance in these communities, because believe it or not, agricultural land actually done right can help to restore the ecological balance of the land, and many other attributes that we'll be getting to today. I love this. These are two very simple axioms that speak to the essence of sustainable agriculture. Ecology is the prime economy, and ecological function is true wealth. When you leave here today, stop somebody on the street and ask them what is true wealth. I'm sure they'll say, my bank account, my real estate holdings. We've got a long educational process to go in this country to realize that that's where it all comes from. And by the way, I cite this essay, Lesson in Identity, by Byron Joel, who's a permaculture practitioner, designer, and instructor in Australia, because he was asked to come to Morocco to speak to an indigenous village on permaculture and give what's called a permaculture design course. And he was very uncomfortable about this because he knew this was a traditional community where people had lived and farmed the land for generations. And he said, I'm a young upstart from a wealthy country. How dare I come to these people and tell them how to farm? And he changed his approach, spent 3 days talking to the people, just getting to know them and their issues and their approach to agriculture, and basically co-led his design course with the folks he was supposed to be teaching. And it was amazingly successful. Many young people developed permaculture designs for their land, and it was a totally different approach and quite a learning experience for the teacher. So I highly recommend the essay. It's absolutely beautiful. This is a slide from a wonderful study, which is beyond the scope of this session, but it's on the value of natural ecosystems, a study written by Robert Costanza, who's an ecological economist. And take a look at the study. It's wonderful. It talks about the value of the natural world in providing for human civilization being as significant, if not far more significant, than the value of our total human economy. But I'm showing the slide for a different reason. It's a wonderful illustration of the fact that everything we are, everything we do, including our agriculture, is nested within the natural world, natural capital. So the built capital, our buildings, our farms, the human capital, our knowledge, our financial capital, social capital, are all subsystems within the natural world. And if we want to increase and protect human well-being, we have to do it while we're also protecting and restoring the natural world. And it all starts with the soil. It's amazing what scientists have discovered about soil microbiology in just the last few years. Conventional agriculture focuses on three nutrients, phosphorus, nitrogen, and potassium. There's probably 40 or 50 micronutrients which are critical to plant growth as well. And those micronutrients are produced by the biological activity of healthy soil. In a spoonful of healthy soil, there could be as many as 6 billion organisms. But it's also about the seeds. Obviously, protecting seeds, making a wide variety of seeds available. Even, of course, seed development to make seeds more resilient to climate change and other risks. This is just as critical as the soil. These are the core elements, the soil, the seeds, and of course the people. We're part of this process too. What do we value? What kind of food do we want to eat? Do we understand our relationship to our food? Are we making demands on our producers to give us food that will nourish us and make our lives more wholesome? I need to put my glasses on for this. So the soil, seed, and people are all part of the larger system of life, that nested system that I just described from Costanza's slide. This system's view builds on the realization that everything in the biosphere, the system of life on Earth, is connected to everything else. When we significantly impact one part of this system, there are ramifications everywhere. The Gaia effect, if anybody's familiar with that term. It's about the context and visualizing desired outcomes versus merely attempting to solve problems. And I want to stress this because this is an underpinning element of sustainable agriculture. We're not just trying to solve nutrient problems. We're not just trying to solve nutrition problems. Yes, those are all dimensions of this, but we want to create a healthful agricultural system that meets those objectives that I had on the board before. I want to close up by talking about the emerging field of agroecology. Agroecology has evolved to address the key challenges of mitigating environmental impacts of agriculture while dramatically increasing global food production, improving livelihoods, and thereby reducing chronic hunger and malnutrition throughout the coming decades. It's an interesting new field. It's probably about 30 years old in its inception. It is an area of science, but it is also a movement. I don't know if any of you know of Los Campesinos, a farmer activist movement in Latin America, very much built around agroecology principles and permaculture. And it's also a set of practices. Permaculture systems, those integrated systems I mentioned before, are evolving practices that many farmers all around the world are using to have their agricultural systems mimic nature and have yields of multiple crops simultaneously, as well as livestock on the same land. And there are some amazing stories of people farming 1 or 2 acres and supporting 40 or 50 families in the process. So the science of agroecology bears a few moments of discussion. It conceptualizes agriculture within the context of global change, not just climate change, of course, but also biodiversity loss, the many challenges we're facing with land use changes through human development. And it's a study of what are called coupled systems, the agricultural production system coupled with environmental systems and social systems. That's what the essence of agroecology is. And it's attempting to deal with the challenges associated with massive amounts of nutrient loading as a result of modern agriculture. There is now as much nitrogen cycling through the globe from human endeavor, primarily agriculture, as there is from natural cycles. And over the last 50 years, there's been a twofold increase in the amount of nitrogen used on agricultural land and a threefold increase in the amount of phosphorus. And unfortunately, much of that does not go into the plants. It's not taken up by the plants. It ends up running off farm fields and causing what are termed dead zones throughout the world, most notably the Gulf of Mexico in the United States, which is seeing huge amounts of areas that are not at all hospitable to life because there's just a massive amount of nutrient loading, which is causing biological system collapse. So our presenters, we are very fortunate to have three incredibly knowledgeable, engaged, contributing people here with us today. And I apologize, I'm going to try to read all this. You can read along with me, but I want to give people their due credit. First, John Fullerton is the founder and president of Capital Institute, which is a collaborative working to explore and effect economic transition to a more just, regenerative, and sustainable way of living through a transformation of finance. His focus is very much on developing effective finance systems to promote regenerative economy. And as you can see, John has been involved in many other areas promoting green business, sustainable business, including being the director of a company called Grasslands LLC, which I'll talk about. Then Kathleen Friff is the president and executive director of Glenwood Farm, an agricultural nonprofit based in New York's Hudson Valley that advances food system transformation and works to ensure that farming thrives in this region. And she was previously the managing director of the Center for Health and the Global Environment at Harvard University's Medical School. Derek Denkel is an impact investor, and he is the founder and director of the nonprofit Slow Money NYC, which is a network of 1,300 members, all collaborating to advance local agriculture and food systems by providing financing to local businesses. So again, we're very fortunate to have these speakers with us today. So why did I call this a forum? Besides the fact that there's a funny little icon there, a forum is a place, a meeting, or a medium where ideas and views on a particular issue can be exchanged. And the way this is structured today, after our introductory presentations, first we're going to have a panel discussion where I'm going to pose some questions to the panelists. I'm going to ask them to question each other on areas of their work. I prefer not getting audience questions at that point unless you require a clarification. That will run for about a half hour. And by the way, we have a 10-minute break before that. And then we'll have an audience Q&A session. And I have to ask you, please, since we have so many people here today, be very succinct in your question, and we'll try to get to as many questions as possible. So with that, I want to turn it over to John. But first, let me again remind you, we do have a hashtag here. So send us your questions. John, thank you very much.
Thanks, Jeff.
Next slide on this one.
Okay, on the left side?
On the left side.
All right, does this one go?
Yeah.
All right. Can I turn that off?
Okay.
Everyone hear me all right? Good, I won't use that. Well, thanks, Jeff. That was a great tee-up for what I wanted to talk about. And just let me give you a very brief, I'm going to try to keep in 20 minutes, right?
Yes, please.
Can you be really aggressive? More aggressive with me.
Yeah. Timekeeper, okay. Can you sit over there so that it's easy to see?
So just as a quick bit of context, my background is as a banker. That's a little unusual to be coming talking about regenerative or sustainable agriculture. I spent nearly 20 years at what I like to call the old J.P. Morgan. I left in 2001 and began thinking about systems and our economic system and our financial system and what's wrong. And then the financial collapse happened. And so I've now started a small nonprofit called Capital Institute, which is wrestling with these kind of big, almost metaphysical questions. Woody Cash, who is the founder of Slow Money is an old friend of mine, and he said to me once, food is ground zero for sustainability. And I really think that's true, and so I poured into studying the food water issues as a way to understand what sustainability means, and have learned a tremendous amount of that I now try to essentially apply to systems more broadly. So that's the journey that I've been on. So what I thought I'd do before I get to the big is to dive down onto the ground and talk about two of the investment projects I'm involved in, which hopefully will give us a glimmer of hope to offset our minds from the really very troubling and distressing macro situation, and we didn't even really get into a lot of the issues that are all connected. But this is a company that I invested in many years ago now. It's an organic greenhouse about an hour south of Washington, D.C. And we started out trying to grow heirloom tomatoes. So the idea was grow vegetables on the East Coast where most of the people live, so you eliminate the food miles, blah, 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 and organic and healthy soil and all that good stuff. Turns out there's a reason why we don't have a lot of heirloom tomatoes in the supermarkets at any kind of scale, because it's really hard to grow heirloom tomatoes, and it's even harder to grow them at a scale that makes it a viable business. So after struggling for years and having the greenhouse blown over by a hailstorm, we're back up and running, and we've kind of backed into or lucked into a new little niche, which is microgreens. And the reason it's worth talking about microgreens is that not only are they not, you know, toxic for you because they're organic, they're actually incredibly nutrient-dense food. And so one of my pet peeves is that this whole conversation about food, and you did mention it, we have to get off the conversation about non-toxic food and onto the conversation about nutrient-dense food. And it's a longer conversation, but these microgreens make kale seem like junk food, and it's really quite exciting. And we've actually managed to figure out how to grow these at a fairly high, at a large scale per acre because we're in a greenhouse. So to put that into some numbers, those little packages you see, we're now selling 9,000 of those a week, which translates into almost 500,000 pounds. Of high nutrient density food per year, and we're still a little tiny company. So I think there's opportunities to grow lots of healthy, nutrient-dense food on relatively small footprints with the advantages of some technology like a greenhouse. This is not a complicated technology, which will alleviate some of these otherwise pretty depressing pathways that we see. So I'm just gonna leave it at that for now. Another project that I'm involved in, and this one really is the one that pulled me into systems thinking and a understanding of the difference between holistic thinking and reductionist thinking, which if I could say one thing today that matters, it's the distinction between reductionist thinking and holistic thinking, because it's going to permeate everything we do as we try to think and learn how to actually live on this planet in a way that's sustainable. And that's not an easy shift, particularly when we've been used to thinking in a reductionist way for 500 years since the Enlightenment. Where I learned about that is through this project with Alan Savory and the Savory Institute, where we do holistic planned grazing. And I encourage you to go to Savory Institute's website, learn a lot about it. But the basic idea, as Jeff said, is to learn from nature how grasslands remain healthy. And the key distinction about the grasslands compared to, say, forests is that there needs to be a symbiotic relationship between animals and grass. The grass doesn't drop its leaves and recycle carbon. It requires the interaction of large herds of animals to do that. And Alan Savory, who is now in his 70s, figured this out in Africa, watching natural herds move around. And of course, if you think about the context in the United States, we essentially killed off 60 million buffalo who used to do this naturally. And the reason that there's so much rich soil under the breadbasket is because for thousands and thousands and millions of years, we had this healthy symbiotic relationship between large herbivores moving in dense herds to protect themselves from predators. They then intensely turn over the soil with their big hooves. They recycle not only organic matter, but all these nutrients that are in their gut. But then they move on because they don't want to sit there and eat in their waste. And so you have this intensive grazing and then rest cycle. And what Alan did and others, there are a lot of people involved in developing this, was to study that process and then essentially replicate it through a management practice. But it's not simple rotational grazing, you know, 20 days over here, 20 days over there. That's very reductionist, very mechanistic thinking. It needs to adjust to the context. So if there's more rain, it means one thing. If there's less rain, it means another thing. If there's more of a certain kind of plant growing, it means a different thing. But the hopeful and exciting opportunity in this is that we've now demonstrated, and we've been involved in this, I've been involved in this for 5 years, they've been doing this for 40 years, we've demonstrated that we can take a conventionally managed pasture, think of, you know, most of Texas, most of Kansas, or not Kansas, most of Wyoming, Montana, the Western Dakotas, we can move into an area like that and essentially double the stocking rate compared to conventional practice while actually increasing biological diversity, plant growth, and therefore the amount of animals per acre that the ranch can handle. So there's this huge untapped potential that is, in those parts of the world, the only way you're going to grow edible food is essentially large animals. And, you know, I would yearn for the days when the buffalo roamed as well. But given that we have 9 billion people on the planet, managing the cattle that exists on the planet and getting them out of the feedlots and back onto the grass where they can be healthy and they can do their part in the system is, in my opinion, a critical piece of the puzzle. And it turns out that grass-fed, grass-finished beef is actually not, in appropriate amounts, is actually not bad for you the way industrial feedlot-fed beef is, that's filled with antibiotics and is fed grain that they're not designed to eat. So that's, again, a much longer conversation, but this is just a photograph of what it looks like to manage herds in a dense, in dense herds, and then essentially we have cowboys out there that move them around, and it's been an amazing regeneration of the cowboy culture as well. It turns out that it's really hard to make a living as a cowboy in the current industrial feedlot system because all the money essentially goes to the big companies that control it. This is a way for the cowboy culture to actually survive in this country and in all parts of the world, and the U.S. is a relatively small piece of the total rangeland management. So again, I just throw that out as a quick idea. Getting back to the importance of holism, there's a book called Holism and Evolution by Jan Smuts. He was the general in the Boer War in South Africa, and as a result, a controversial figure, but he was a genius and wrote an amazing book. He coined the term holism and explained that essentially we live in a world of nested wholes, and the relationships between the wholes are much more important than the parts. And yet our entire industrial model is set up in this idea of reducing what's complicated into pieces that we can manage, and then we wonder why all these things that are interconnected cause all these problems. But staying in a reductionist mind frame, we try to solve the problems rather than getting to the root cause, which is understanding how holistic systems work. And Einstein, I wasn't able to find this quote, but I read about it, so I'm going to use it anyway. He seemed to get the importance of this. So we've studied not just the projects I've invested in, but I actually see Susan is here. I didn't see you earlier, Susan. Hi. My colleague Susan Artarian Chang. We've now, over the last 5 years, studied some 35 different projects around the world to discern what the principles are of regenerative projects and all toward building up to a new theory of how healthy systems work, which is essentially a new theory of economics when you apply it to economics. And we launched this work last year at Yale University with a paper I wrote called Regenerative Capitalism, How Universal Principles and Patterns Will Shape Our New Economy. I consider it sort of the 1.0 version of this work. The basic idea, and it borrows from and integrates lots of great thinking. There's probably not a lot of original thinking in it. It's more an integration. One of the places we get a lot of that thinking is from the permaculture community. Another one is from a group that's involved in regenerative real estate development. And this chart really resonated with me when I first saw it. To explain the distinction between regenerative and sustainable. You know, regenerative means a system that's self-organizing, self-sustaining, ever-learning. Think of it as an upward spiral. It's a dynamic process, which is essentially explains why we're all in this room living and breathing, because our bodies, literally at the cellular level, are constantly regenerating. And if everything is energy, and all systems are energy systems, then our hypothesis is that we should think about human economies and certainly the financial system that needs to support it as just another example of an energy flow network, and to study the science of energy flow networks and the practice of regenerative projects happening in the real world to discern principles for how economies need to be organized. And so the idea is that we can't get from degenerative industrial models that we operate in today to something called sustainable without going well beyond it, restoring both social and natural capital we've destroyed, as well as shifting into this regenerative frame. And the paper talks about what that looks like. I don't have time to go into it today, but just to give you a quick peek, these are the eight principles we've discerned. Let me just talk about the first one, in right relationship. How am I doing on time? Ah, more than okay. In right relationship is probably the central principle, if there is one, of all of these. Although all of these work in a regenerative way only when they work together, again, as a pattern. It's not an a la carte menu that you can choose some and not the others. They work as your all the parts in your body work if they're all working together in an integrated way. But if you think about just the in-right relationship for a second, the cattle have a relationship with the grass, that the health of the pasture system, which by the way is the second largest carbon sink after the oceans. So healthy grasslands is far more important to the health of the whole ecosystem than most people are aware. And we're, a lot of our work is about measuring carbon sequestration on landscape scale, which is actually, should have mentioned earlier, is one of the really hopeful opportunities there. But obviously all the parts in our body need to be working in relationship with each other. Gregory Bateson, the great systems thinker, used to put his hand up and ask people, what do you see here? And of course people would say, I see a hand, and then he'd say, what else? And they would say, five fingers. And then he would say, what else? Does anyone have an idea? What else?
Microbes.
Microbes? What else?
The rest of your body.
No, pretend it's just my hand. So there's four relationships here. And the essence of a hand is actually not five fingers. It's the relationship between five fingers and how they work together. Otherwise, it's not a hand. So, and that's true in everything from, cellular level and atomic level, like H2O, two parts hydrogen, one part oxygen, are just molecules. You put them together and you have water. So the relationships are the key. And if you think about our modern capitalist system, what do? And I know a little bit about this. I spent 20 years doing this. We think the pursuit of efficiency through capital markets is the aim. And so we've segregated the relationship between owners and big enterprises. And we wonder why we can't get these big companies to operate in a healthy way when we have literally no relationship between owners and enterprise. We have stock traders who are transient, not even owners, they're just transient contractual right owners, but there's literally no owner of Monsanto. It's a series of stock traders who are in and out of the stock as if it's just a commodity. So wrestling with the health of the global economy gets back to getting real on what the real principles are, and I'm committed, I've essentially committed my life work to the belief that these principles come from living systems, and so that sustainable regenerative agriculture is far more important than just healthy food and healthy environment. It actually needs to inform everything we do in terms of how we organize society. I mentioned earlier that we have a storytelling initiative called the Field Guide to Investing in a Regenerative Economy that Susan leads at Capital Institute. And I'll talk about just a couple of kind of unexpected projects that we've discovered. The first one is a family farm in Iowa, I think. Susan? I think it's Iowa. And they have a relationship with Danone, which we say Danon, that's quite unusual. It's a family farm that was in a co-op, and basically the co-op gave them no relationship with their customers, and their milk was treated as a commodity. So cooperatives are interesting, and there's a lot of interesting cooperatives, and we're in favor of exploring those, but they're no panacea, particularly if they breach one of the fundamental relationships, which is between an enterprise and its customer. And it turns out that Danone Yogurt, for their premium quality products, wanted a secure supply chain and wasn't able to get it through the organic milk industry. So they contracted directly with this farm in a cost-plus basis so that it assured the farm essentially a guaranteed living. And they assured healthy milk supply. It's not organic, but they use much less of all the bad stuff, and that's what Dana needed. So the point is that not all sustainable agriculture is going to look the same, and focusing on the principles we think is a better path toward finding the solutions that we need. Another one is this is a bank that is in Australia, and Bendigo Bank. They were challenged with how to bring banking to the unbanked rural communities in Australia. And they couldn't afford to set up branches in these places, and all the other banks that had been in these places left. But what they could do is bring their infrastructure and work in partnership with local nonprofits, who essentially became the local offices for this bank. And so through that relationship, they've now got something like, I think it's 40 branches around Australia. And the deal is that the profits are shared between the bank and the local nonprofit. And the local nonprofit has to reinvest them, which is one of the principles, robust circulation, reinvesting profits in community. So the local nonprofits then reinvest the shared profits of this, it's essentially a network of banking institutions, back in their local community. And since they've been doing this for the last roughly 20 years, I think something like $40 million has been reinvested in these communities. So the idea of regenerative systems is that they unlock potential that we don't know exists until you try them. It's another reason to be hopeful that you don't just extrapolate linearly the current trends, you actually unlock potential that we didn't know exists. I'll leave it at that and look forward to discussion.
Hi, John, thank you very much. Now Kathleen is going to speak.
Hi, everybody. Can you all hear me all right?
Yes.
Great. So I've been asked to talk about the work of Glenwood, an organization I run, as has been mentioned, in the Hudson Valley. And I'm just going to share some examples of our work in hopes that it will kind of spur the dialogue that we're going to have later about what it takes to actually make the kind of food system that many of us want. So our mission is really to re-regionalize the Hudson Valley in terms of farming and food. And our vision is a region that is defined by that activity. The idea that farmers can grow locally in ways that are regenerative and that support the natural environment are doing so in a way that they make a living and are celebrating a sense of place, a sense of community. So we talk a lot about the reason we do this work through health. So through we think that this kind of regionalization of a food system is healthier for us humans. You get better food. It's healthier for the environment, the context in which we farm. It's healthier for the local economy. And it creates a sense of place. I was delighted to see, John, that was one of the eight principles, is this idea that we're connected to the place we live. And it's our belief that food is one of the primary ways that we can make that connection. So I'm just going to go through a couple of examples. Obviously, regionalizing a food system is a tall order, especially since our conventional food system is so ingrained, and I think has led to this separation and lack of acknowledgement that most Americans have that food isn't critical to their health and well-being. Food arguably is the most critical element in our health and the health of our region. So addressing that disconnect takes a lot of effort. We work a lot with many peer organizations that are all focused on this effort. It's a big order. And how to find those leverage points, the infrastructure that's needed, the relationships that are needed to really build a sustainable system that's economically viable, it's tough. And I'm going to share with you some of the the ideas and projects that we're working on in the Hudson Valley, and then we can have a discussion. We approach a lot of our work through building relationships. So if there's been one kind of big lesson in the time that I've been trying to tackle this puzzle of creating a regional food system, it's that it is work that is about humans. It is a very human endeavor, and it's really about those relationships. More so than any work I've ever done in my career, it's about putting people together. And often in a region like the Hudson Valley, when it's pretty big and people are busy, they don't have the opportunity to collaborate collectively to really address the issues, to facilitate an understanding of what the true challenges are. So our role as a nonprofit trying to do this work often means we bring people together to explore what has to happen in order to make their livelihoods better, or what the opportunities are, or to share knowledge. And so you're going to hear that throughout these examples, is that we, Glenwood plays that role of creating that hub of learning and sharing at our home farm. So we have this really unique facility about an hour from here near Cold Spring, New York. And we have the ability to bring people together. There's some housing there so people can come for multi-day experiential visits where we can really bring people together and tackle some problems. So we farm on that property. We have about 250 acres. We do a vegetable production that's in a CSA model. How many people know what CSA means? I'm curious. Community supported agriculture. So that's when the clients of the farmer will pay up front and then get a share usually on a weekly basis during the harvest. It's good for the farmer because it gets them money when they need it the most. So we have a CSA farm vegetable production, and then we also have a very diverse pasture-based livestock operation. We farm at Glenwood so that we know firsthand what the challenges and what the opportunities are for the farmers that we represent throughout the region. So gives us a real hands-on ability to see what our constituents are going through on a daily basis. We also model best practices, and we're animal welfare approved for our livestock. We do have organic certification, and then that allows us to demonstrate those practices for other farms throughout the region. We try out new things. We try out really scrappy, inexpensive technology that we think can be replicated on farms in the Hudson Valley. And share our business decision making so that other farms, again, can learn from what we're doing on our home farm. The farm also allows us to train beginning farmers. So as many of you may know, farmers are aging out in this country. And whereas family farms often had their next generation tending to their farms, that's not happening right now. So we're losing our farmers. So there's a recognition that we need to train a new cohort, a new generation of farmers. And luckily, at the same time, there is emerging a group of very passionate people who are interested in the values that we just went through. Environmental resiliency, a sort of lifestyle that celebrates food and farming. But they didn't grow up on a family farm. They didn't, by osmosis, get all of that information and skill that traditionally farmers got throughout their lifetime. So the challenge is then, how do we provide that training to those farmers? So we at Glenwood have an apprentice program. We train 5 apprentices every year. And then there's many other programs throughout the Hudson Valley that we work really closely with. So there's a whole network of apprenticeships that's happening in the Hudson Valley right now. We've been doing this work since about 2008, and at last look, 90% of the apprentices that we've trained are still in food and farming. So it's not the case usually that they come and they find out farming's really hard and then they go back to whatever they were doing. These are people that are really, really dedicated to building this alternative food system, especially in the Hudson Valley. However, when you finish an apprenticeship program, like the one I just described, you typically a season, a long season. Ours are 9 to 11 months. But you might not be ready to start your own farm or even manage a farm. So there has, again, another recognition that we've learned by bringing a lot of folks together in the Hudson Valley is that there was a gap in terms of the training to take someone from an apprenticeship level to someone who can really manage and run their own farm. So we launched a farm business incubator, not unlike incubators in other sectors. We essentially provide many resources to these new entry farmers to allow them to start what we hope will be, what we're betting will be, a successful farm business based in the Hudson Valley. So we do this on another piece of property that we manage near New Paltz, New York, about 2 hours from here, where we provide them access to land, which is probably the largest hurdle to start a farm business in the Hudson, especially in the Hudson Valley. Access to shared equipment, there's housing, and then they have a whole range of curriculum that is everything from business management to budgeting to tractor skills. What we work with them individually, figure out what they need. We help them brand, we help them figure out their sales channels, essentially holding their hands so that they have what could be a viable business model. And then the idea is that they will fledge onto permanent land in the Hudson Valley. And again, the land access challenge is finding those properties for these new farmers. And we've been working increasingly with private landowners and land trusts who can make land affordable through a variety of mechanisms for those new farmers. The other main part of our work at Glenwood is to really promote the food of the Hudson Valley. So I talked a lot about how our work wants to create a region that is known for its food and farming. And we do that through a variety of ways, and I'm just gonna run through some of the projects. We have been leading an effort to popularize hard cider, alcoholic cider made from orchards in the Hudson Valley, so orchard-based cider. And that work has been tremendously successful. I hope all of you enjoy cider. We started with 5 cider producers in the Hudson Valley. We actually took them to France to interact with producers in Normandy who have an uninterrupted history of cider production to learn the craft. There are now to date over 60 cider producers in the Hudson Valley. We take a lot of credit for growing that industry, much like the craft beer industry has grown. But the result, and what we're most interested in terms of our mission, is that it keeps apple orchards viable. So Apple's long legacy in New York State, struggling to keep up, the fresh apple market is a tough one. And this is a way for those apple growers to have another venue for selling their product. So, and that has been the case. We are helping apple orchards stay in the ground and diversifying apples because cider apple varieties haven't been grown to production in the Hudson Valley for many, many years. So we host 2 big events every year, Cider Week, where Hudson Valley cider is featured on menus and stores in New York City and in the Hudson Valley. So look out for that. This is very successful work. We're replicating this approach with, again, a group of producers in the Hudson Valley that are doing value-added meats, so charcuterie and other shelf-stable meats. Again, we brought these producers together. We tried to figure out what they need most in order to make a successful industry, to create demand for their products that rely on pasture-based livestock. So it's kind of part of the trying to figure out where all the points are and putting them together. So one of the things that they identified was that, the craft was really important to them. The kind of guru of charcuterie is this guy named Francois Vecchier. He's hard to get a training from, and he's on the West Coast. So we convinced him to spend a week with these producers at Glenwood, where he was just doing one-on-one teaching for them, which has led to critically improve their products. And we're going to be working on, in a similar way, promoting Hudson Valley charcuterie. Again, it's about kind of going all the way back to the farm for those efforts. Another example of a network that we brought together is a group of farmers and chefs and seed growers. So this was a collaboration with an organization called Hudson Valley Seed Library. A seed library is an outgrowth of an actual book library in this country, but it's a place where folks produce seeds. Hudson Valley Seed Library is producing seed that has been bred to be specifically well grown in this region. So it's the regionalization of seed production, which is a relatively new area that we're really excited about, especially given our work on wanting to really define the Hudson Valley as a food and farming region. So this was a really beautiful story. This guy named Hank in Ghent, in New York, was a home gardener. He cultivated a white bean, and he was famous for it. He was famous for the taste of his bean. Years and years and years spent growing this bean, changing it, breeding it. And long after he died, his daughter found one little jar of his beans in his basement, gave those beans to the seed library. The seed library had been slowly cultivating them to create more beans. And last year, last season, we collaborated with them. We commissioned, I think, 7 or 8 farms to grow the bean. And then we commissioned a network of chefs, farm-to-table chefs that we've been working with at Glenwood, to serve the bean in the Hudson Valley in a Hudson Valley cassoulet. So the bean is called Hank's Extra Special Bean. It's called Extra Special because the founder of the Hudson Valley Seed Library wanted a seed with every letter, and he needed an X. So it's a really beautiful story. They also do this. The image here is they commission artists to do all their seed packets. But the impact of that on a regional food system is, one, you identify products, seeds that grow into crops that are easy for farmers to grow, that are grown for the region, so they speak of the region, and that could be celebrated in a way that got a lot of attention. This got a tremendous amount of attention because the story is kind of romantic and beautiful. But you know, white cooking beans, kind of a hard sell. So, you know, we're doing 2 more grow outs this season, also choosing crops that that might not be as popular, that could use some attention, but that benefit the farms. So they're easy to grow, they're inexpensive to grow, the farmers are going to make money on it because the chefs are going to buy it for their restaurant. One last example of our work is we've created a coalition of most of the CSA farmers in the Hudson Valley. And again, we did this just as I explained, just to bring folks together to find out what could be helpful for them, recognizing that as a group, they can be more powerful than their individual part, than their individual efforts. So marketing CSAs in the Hudson Valley is a challenge for our farmers. They actually sell way more CSA shares in the city than they do in their own neighborhoods. And there's an explicit desire by these farmers to serve more of their local community, having a tough time getting those folks to understand what CSA is, how they can benefit. So we're creating this campaign. It hasn't launched yet, it's under construction, but it's a really fun campaign playing on the acronym CSA, so consume something awesome. And then it changes, so it can be like cut spring asparagus, or, you know, so it's a fun way that recognizes CSA might not be a very informative title for this type of farming. But there will be a directory on it, so it's sort of one stop where someone can go and find a CSA, learn about those farms, learn about their practices. And eventually, this coalition is seeking to do things that have been replicated in other regions where they've convinced health insurance companies to subsidize their CSA subscription, much like some health insurance companies will give you a voucher for the gym, right? So that would allow, you know, promote the CSA for more residents in these areas. And lastly, we do a number of public programs. And again, this is just to help our community understand what we're working on, how we're doing, how we're creating a regional food system, and why we think that's critical and very essential to health and well-being. So we have a couple, you know, open farm days, and we also do a farm dinner series once a month where folks can come up and share food, share a meal with each other. It's procured from our farmers in the Hudson Valley, and really talk about these issues. And this, I think, is one of the most compelling parts of the work in sustainable ag, is that there's real joy in this work. So as opposed to spending a lot of time thinking about climate change and loss of biodiversity, those things are critical. But the wonderful thing about working with food and agriculture is it's seductive. You get to eat and share and cook with people you love, and it's joyful. So I think that's a really powerful part of this work that's drawing a lot of folks in, because they can actually celebrate. It's undeniably more satisfying than eating junk from a grocery store. It just is. It's undeniable. So thank you so much for coming, and bon appétit.
Real joy in this work. Kathleen, thank you very much. And finally, Derek.
Well, thanks.
I've been told to talk into the mic, so maybe I'll take a handheld because that's a little low for me. Hi, I'm Derek, and I'm going to talk about slow money, dovetailing, I think, nicely with John and Kathleen in the program. Slow money is a movement that came out of the Terra Madre conference in 2007, which is the political conference that slow food champions. So the connection between the two, if you've made it in your mind already, is quite close. So slow food is to fast food as slow money is to fast money. And a lot of the perspective on this you'll recognize in some of John's comments is very aligned between the two of us. Slow food movement came from Carlo Petrini, the founder of that movement, reacting to the creation or the announcement of the creation of a McDonald's in Rome. And he felt that fast food coming to a culture that had was built on food as a grounding foundation of their identity, and being interrupted by this global food company that is emphasizing speed and commodification, he felt like was anathema. And the slow food movement came out of that to respond and provide a counterweight to it. And the Terra Madre movement was a globalization of that that movement. And Petrini changed what John mentioned earlier, who's the then an impact investor running the largest angel investor network in the world called Investor Circle, think about how to slow money down the same way that they thought about slowing food down to respond to globalization, industrialization, and commodification, and all of the negative externalities that those things cause, extraction, exploitation, and destruction of culture, landscapes, and people. And so Woody Tash wrote a book in 2007 to respond to that challenge, looking into investing into food and farms as if they mattered. So that gave rise to conversations that then Woody Tash began having with a variety of people in the investment community and the food communities, and gave rise to a movement to try to experiment with this thesis of investing as if foods, farms, and fertility mattered on a local level. And so their mission of the organization that came out of that is to catalyze the flow of capital to local food system by developing a network of entrepreneurs, farmers, and investors guided by new impact investment principles connected to place. You've heard that theme before, rooted in relationships and respecting both human dignity and environmental limits. So this is an investment thesis that we attempt to enact. And many people agree with us. Is this a small movement or a big movement? It's been around since 2007. You'll see a goofy picture of me in the corner. But anyways, this is taken from our website, but there are principles that are guiding this investment thesis that that mission undergirds. And so far, 33,000 people have signed on to those principles. And some of those principles are challenges to do things differently. So here are some of the challenges in the principles. What would the world be like if we invested 50% of our assets within 50 miles of where we live? What if there were a new generation of companies that gave away 50% of their profits? In other words, challenging us to think both about how we do invest in food differently and how we run companies differently. And what if 50% more organic matter was put into our soil 50 years from now, and that was part of our investment thesis, to invest in the soil as well as balance sheet. So it's a growing movement. There's 23 networks across the United States, and there are actually six abroad, and investment clubs that are experimenting with this thesis throughout the country, so quite widely spread. Recently, we did a study in 2014. This is a bit old now, this data, but at that time, slow money-related enterprises and investors had done $46 million of transaction over 470 deals in just 6 years. So 2007, the book was written, 2008, the movement started, and so investment activity only really started in late 2008. So it's really almost 5 years that this happened. So is that a lot of activity? Let's gauge it in terms of global numbers. So at the same time in 2009, this is an interesting benchmark year, 2009, the amount of money invested in food and beverage businesses at the in traditional food and beverage businesses was $100 million as quantified. And by 2015, that was $500 million. So there's been an incremental increase of investment in food and beverage businesses over that time period as well, interest in the sector. Slow money deals represent what we believe is roughly 10% of those deals. But to contrast that, the sector that's referred to as ag tech in the same period went from $500 million, which is where food and beverage, traditional food and beverage is now in 2015, and it was $500 million here, to $5 billion last year. So ag tech, which is sort of what we might define here as the enemy of good food, is on a scale where Soul Money is 10 times less than traditional food and beverage, and traditional food and beverage is 10 times less than ag tech, which includes a lot of the systems for globalization, commodification, and extractive practices that we're trying to provide a counterweight to in this dialogue. So we were formed here, Slow Money NYC, in 2010 after attending a national gathering of Slow Money, then a very nascent small organization in Shelburne, Vermont. We immediately formed an organization of a lot of us in the investment and food community, thinking we had to take action, and began to try to experiment with ways to enact our investment thesis here in New York City. We did that through using some social tools, having a meetup with regular meetings that's grown from 10 members to 1,350 in the last 5 years. We formed an the first angel investor group in the country dedicated to sustainable local food, which has vacillated. We've had 60 members over the years, currently 45. And we've invested in several deals, which I'll mention later. We have an annual summit, which we just completed, much to my relief, week before last, called Food and Enterprise, where we explore the intersection between these folks. And like Kathleen was saying, a lot of what we do is convening people to have dialogues about how to enact this investment thesis. We don't know what the answer is, but we want to have people talking about what they think the answer is and try to come up with the solutions collectively. So what have we done in terms of promoting investment here locally? So we have the angel investor group that we get together, but we've also tried some experiments. Some of them are shown here. Some of them have failed, and we're not showing them here. But so one thing that we just did last year, because we really have been struggling with how to both democratize investment, because investment, as you probably know, is very segregated between categories of people called accredited investors, who are very, very wealthy people who represent maybe 10% of our population, maybe less. Someone will correct me. I'm sure the statistic is too high. It's probably less than that. People who have $250,000 of income a year or $2 million more in assets, excluding their home. So we tried to create democratic vehicles for investment, which angel groups are not explicitly. So we created the Local Farms Fund, which allows anybody to invest in Pennsylvania, Connecticut, New York, and New Jersey, any investor in those states, to invest in a farmer who's looking for farmland. So it's not a speculative land tool, so I'll get to that in a minute. Then we also created a collaboration with Kiva Zip, where we're a trustee, and we endorse loans up to $10,000 at 0% interest for nascent food businesses. And then we've sponsored and assisted in as endorsers of campaigns on Indiegogo, Kickstarter, and Barnraiser. So I'll talk a little bit about the Food and Enterprise Summit and why it's different. I'll go through that quickly. It's an annual event we've done for the last 5 years where we really emphasize the entrepreneurs as kind of the cutting edge thinkers of how to make change in the food system. The investors aren't going to figure it out. They need the people who are kind of pushing the envelope of what business is. How can we be more socially responsive? How can we be more environmentally sensitive? It's the businesses who are pushing these double bottom lines that are separate from the traditional single bottom line of profit only. And so we started in 2011 with just a pitch fest, which was just exploring. We had 100 applicants, put 10 people, 10 businesses up on the stage, and that we thought were exemplary of a new way of thinking about business. And then out of that came excitement to invest in those businesses, and we've maintained that element. We also realized that those businesses needed a lot of support, because of the 100 that were applied, we wanted to support them too, as well as the 10 that were on the stage. So we created an expert exchange, which we have 80 coaches that provide a variety of supportive speed coaching and relationship building for future business relationships at that event. And then we created a marketplace for the entrepreneurs to demonstrate their wares, and then workshops to dialogue on a variety of topics related to the building of the local food shed and relationships between entrepreneurs and investors, including one on cider economic development. So what we do is that we don't want to be a shoot and scoot, a one and done kind of conference organization. So we've done meetups throughout the year, and we have one that now is really gelled into a nice form, which is a monthly pitch workshop for businesses testing their ideas. Again, thinking of the entrepreneurs as the people who are forming the crucible for all these great ideas that we might invest in for a better future. This workshop takes place in collaboration with foodstand.com, an app that's attempting to bring about change through a collaboration online. And I invite you all to come to that. Our next one is May 17th at Purpose. And you can also apply as an entrepreneur. And it's a very flat networking experience where we have experts in the local food system and audience feedback evaluate the sustainability and viability of the businesses that present there. Then we have this bi-monthly meeting of Angel Investor Group that we review enterprise offerings, often businesses that come up through the pipeline of both of the previous events, Good Food Spotlight and Food and Enterprise. They come to us through that. We do traditional angel investing where we have collaborative diligence and we invest individually, so it's not a fund or pooled asset pool. The investment criteria that we explore, and you'd imagine this would be controversial because each of these terms have its own kind of volatility, and we discussed that a lot at lunch about how even defining something as sustainable local or it can be very problematic. But we've attempted to hack out these things through investments that we made, looking mostly at early stage with a very flexible ROI. So here's some examples of businesses that the food shed investors have placed capital in. Restaurants are at the forefront of communicating the good food movement in a lot of ways. And so what our first investment was with Egg Restaurant, a business that has a farm of its own and serves 80% seasonal produce when available. And then a vertically integrated enterprise just recently, this is the most recent investment, a farm that makes its own hot sauce that sells at the Union Square Farmers Market. In addition, we've supported, like John, we've been really interested in grass-fed beef and supported Fleischer's Craft Butchery, which is a four-unit chain, mini chain in the region that also supports a beef cooperative upstate, the largest organic beef cooperative in New York State. And then other farming enterprises in the urban context we've been really intrigued by. In fact, one of our enterprises was a farm fund that supported Brooklyn Grange and Added Value Urban Farm that you see in the bottom there in Red Hook, Brooklyn. We've also supported consumer packaged goods brands that are not associated with farms but with supporting organic agriculture like Blue Marble Ice Cream, which you may be aware of and may not be aware of, that's the only organic ice cream in the Northeast. So Local Farms Fund, just quickly, this was an effort to be both democratic and non-speculative. Speculative land use is what drives up farm prices and makes it hard for farmers to deploy sustainable farming practices. It also makes them hard within urban areas to compete based on land values, like Kathleen was saying. And so we formed This endeavor, it took us a year of discussion to figure out what it would be. We actually conferred with Glenwood and other nonprofits who are investigating restoring agriculture about how we should structure it. It was co-founded with Slow Money and Working Farms Capital, which is an entity that invests in farms in a similar way. And we try to secure land access for early stage farmers in collaboration with the farmer. So we find the farmer first, and then we find the land. So we invest in the farmland with the farmer. The prospective farmers come to us, and we look for land together. We evaluate the farmer along with their character, along with their business plan. And we fund only when both the fund and the farmer agree. The governance also includes the farmer, who sits on the board and reviews decisions about the disposition of the land, which will be leased to the farmer over a 10-year period so that he can purchase it at the end of that period. So we invested in our first farm last year, which is also a really interesting experiment. It's entirely horse-drawn power farm, which will be a CSA serving the Saratoga Springs urban area in upstate New York. We also, I want to highlight some of our Kiva Zip campaigns. Mark Jaffe was the winner of our Pitch Fest in 2014 at Food and Enterprise, so there's this virtuous circle of connectivity that he represents. He also gained a CFO from a member of the board of Slow Money, who was evaluating him at the time as a judge, who was impressed with his model. And then we supported him to purchase a truck through the lending of $10,000 to him through Kiva Zip online deal platform. We're currently supporting the PitchFest competitors from this year, and for as little as $25, you can make a loan to a local food company. So this is a way that we've tried to democratize and engage people in our vision, which is everyone is an investor in food, which is on our website. Everyone is an investor in food if you're an eater, but we want to have people think of themselves more than just as eaters, but that they can expand their impact on the food system by supporting enterprises in deeper ways through CSAs and other means like this. So if anybody wants to participate in any of these campaigns, I will highly urge you to do so. It's a tiny amount of money that will go a long way to help a variety of these social and environmental local food enterprises succeed. And it means a lot to them to get that support. So if anybody would like more information about this, I can tell you later. We've also supported various crowdfunding campaigns, which are donations made to a variety of food companies, either in need or just simply to support their mission. Some of them have been in relationship to tragedies, like Cayuga Pure Organics, which is the largest producer of heirloom beans and grains in New York State at the time, had a disastrous fire where a young child was inadvertently playing with matches and at a dry portion of the season, actually right around this time, and their entire barn burned up. And you think, oh, wouldn't they have insurance to cover that? But of course, it was such a disastrous fire that they exceeded their insurance maximums in terms of what the restoration costs would be. And so we waged a very successful campaign to raise $87,000 for them to make up the difference between their insurance and the actual cost of restoring the barn. And then we've done several Kickstarter campaigns, as well as BarnRaiser, which is a funding platform specifically dedicated to supporting local food movement. Last year at our Pitch Fest, they were similar to the Kiva Zip campaign. This year we had five successfully funded enterprises through that, including our Pitch Fest winner, Made by Lucas, which is a vegan a veggie burger mix. So in conclusion, we'd really like everyone to be involved in this movement. It's our belief that since everyone's an investor in food, everyone should be involved in investing in food and not sit by passively and wait for the investor class to take action or for the entrepreneur creative class to begin to start businesses. It's up to all of us to engage in these businesses in deep ways, in the ways that we do when we go to farmers market and we want to explore what's your growing method and how's it going? Is this business good? You know, the same way you would strike up that conversation, there's ways that you can explore being involved as an investor in these businesses in deeper ways than just being a consumer. And what we're trying to do is activate the notion that the passive stance by which we're all turned into consumers is part of the problem, where we're constantly consuming, but in a way that multiplies the extractive and destructive principles. So the way that everything is sold to us at the lowest possible price as consumers is an unsustainable method of of economic development, whereby it's not in relation to natural limits. So if we think of ourselves as investors, both in the businesses that we seek to support, but also in the future that we wish to bring about in food, fertility, and farms, as if they matter, then we will fundamentally shift our consciousness. And that's what we're attempting to do. So we invite everyone to explore these things with us. And like Kathleen said, the other thing that's kind of great about it is it's just super fun, you know, because you get to go to an event, you hear amazing pitches from businesses that are inspiring you. You eat a popsicle with cayenne pepper and mango. You never had that before. And so you enrich your own experience, expand your own horizons, and you're able to potentially change the food system in an incremental way. So thank you very much.
Derek, thank you very much. So these people are having fun. They're doing real solid work to restore the economic vitality and nutritional value and ecological value of agriculture in our region. This is substantive. It may be incredibly small scale, no doubt about that, but it's substantive in terms of direct benefits, in terms of the education that's bringing the people, anybody they touch in all sectors, all parts in this process. And it's a driver for change, not only a driver for change at this level, but this type of work is inspiring corporations to change as well. So we're seeing some very powerful transitions, albeit small at this point, but starting. And things in human endeavor don't always follow linear paths. This could reach a tipping point much more quickly than we anticipate. So you've heard some great examples here of work being done. We're going to take a 10-minute break just to stretch legs and hit the bathroom. But I want everybody back here as soon as possible so we can have our panel discussion and then our Q&A.